the real highlights and points of wisdom, I'd say, of this book. Hey, welcome to the channel. Today we are going to be talking about Braiding Sweetgrass. By Robin Wall Kimmerer. I listened to the audiobook on this one, which was actually narrated by the author herself. So that's always interesting to have the author themselves narrate, because you get the emphasis on the points they're trying to make. And she narrates it very well. This book is about her view of the world, which is influenced by her indigenous heritage and the wisdom she derives from that knowledge. It's also from her scientific training and background, so she trained as a botanist, so it's from the knowledge she's gained from science. And thirdly, what she classes as the genius of plants as well. And I'll come on to the genius of plants comment and my thoughts on that as well. But I've had to sit and think about this book since I finished it before I could record this. And there are some parts of this book which are exceptional and incredibly insightful, and I would class as true wisdom, which will stick with me and will stay with me. And there's some parts which are not, in my opinion. I should say that this book was recommended to me by Lynn from Book Talking with Library Lynn. I'll link her channel in the description below. And I want to thank her for this, because this was a truly thought-provoking book. And as I say, it's taken a few days to really think through and form what I think about it. So the book has several stages, but we go through and each point we're talking about how nature can teach us, how we can learn from nature, how we can use the indigenous wisdom, focused on North American tribes and their knowledge they've gained of the world in which they lived in, and the plants and animals that made up that world, and how they successfully coexisted together. And then you've also got her intertwining her science knowledge of plants, especially plants, coming from a botanist. So we've got their feeding in, and then we've got her teaching lessons from the plants themselves. And they're all kinds of lessons. We'll come on to some of the key lessons that I think are the real highlights and points of wisdom, I'd say, of this book. So the first one is the importance of language. And her thought process on this was very informative, and it reminded me of a few other things I've read, but effectively how language forms thought. And I don't want to get too Orwellian in my thinking here, but how the language we use, in a sense, limits our thinking, and we think in the language we speak. So you're probably all aware that other languages have different words, and they have words for things that we don't necessarily, and say we, me being an English speaker, that we don't necessarily have words for. And if you don't have a word for it, it's difficult to describe it, and it's difficult to think about things that you don't have the vocabulary to think about. Does that make sense? So, and language also groups your thoughts, and you group similar things depending on how your language works. And the example she gives in the book is how, in English, for example, we group humans as separate from animals in our language. However, in some of the indigenous languages of the Americas, they group living beings as a group, which includes humans, animals, plants, all as one group, and then inanimate beings, so rock, for instance, as a separate entity. So you've got the separation. So the suggestion here is their view of humanity is part of living things and equal to other living things. As in English, potentially, we view humans as separate, and in many ways we view them as superior to other living things. And she does connect this to sort of origin stories. So you, in English, you have probably the Bible is the most well-known origin story from within the English language, and that is, you know, Adam and Eve and how the animals were subjects of the humans, for better phraseology. But then you had, in the indigenous story she tells within this book, the sky woman who comes to the earth and creates the, you know, and that creation story, and it's how it's the giving and receiving of gifts and the, I suppose, equalness, the equality between living things, and doesn't separate humans from that. So that was interesting. And language is a critical point here. And I think it's a fascinating point that I agree with. And as we discuss language, I might as well move on to probably the bit I struggled with most with this book. And that was some of the language. Now, the really positive part of that is she is quite lyrical. She's quite poetic in her language, the way she writes. And that is it's engaging to me. And I enjoyed that way of writing. But the bits I struggled with was sometimes where she would describe or ascribe intelligence to plants as if they were thinking like humans think. And I struggled mentally with that. And she makes some interesting points along that front. But there's a bit there, me, that goes, you know, you have evolution and they've evolved to fill a niche within their environment so they can survive. And to ascribe intelligence, and it seemed like she was ascribing intelligence to their ability to survive and niche. And I think it comes down to, and again, going back to language, what is intelligence? And that is not something I'm going to attempt a definition on now, because there are, dare I say it, more intelligent scholars who have struggled with that. So intelligence, but ascribing intelligence to plants, I struggled with a bit as I was going through it, and it pressed against my scientific leanings, I suppose would be a way of putting it. But that's not to say there's still not wisdom in this book. And one of the key points that came, you know, some more of the key points that came out of this book were the disconnection between humans and nature. And, you know, we see it in our everyday life. And I think everybody sees it. And I remember when I was a kid having this discussion with my dad. So I grew up in a farming and agricultural family. And I was always stunned that people didn't really know where their food came from. Or some people didn't know where their food came from. And I grew up quite a rural town, but even within rural towns, and it's potentially even more exaggerated than cities, where they don't have the same exposure to farm life, you don't necessarily understand where the food in supermarkets comes from, and therefore you don't appreciate where it comes from and the effort and the expense, in every sense of the word, of creating food for people. And I think that disconnection does drive certain behaviours, and she makes a good point around this, and it's engaging in the sense that we don't take care of stuff that we can't see, and we don't take care or responsibility for our actions if we don't see the consequences. And there's that, again, the disconnection between what we do and the impact it has, and we don't necessarily marry the two up within ourselves and within society as a whole. So that disconnection really rang true to me, and it was she put it much more poetically than I am here, but it was a point that I really strongly agreed with. So the other two points really, really fit together, and are probably the part of the title of what I've put this book review down as. But there's two of them. So gratitude first, and appreciation begets abundance, and they're kind of interlinked. But the idea that, you know, what we receive from the natural world then is a gift that we should be grateful for, you know, that the food and all the materials and pretty much everything that exists in our life has come from the world itself. Not pretty much, everything that exists, that we use, that we have, has come in some way from resources in the earth itself. And having the gratitude of that, and the more we show gratitude, the more we also will gain in return. But we shouldn't show gratitude just for personal gain in return. We should show gratitude because we are grateful for the gifts of the world. And she makes a brief analogy regarding appreciation begets abundance, whereby, you know, if she, I can't remember exactly the analogy, but something like, you know, if she bakes cookies for somebody, and, you know, and they are grateful and you know, give gratitude, saying thank you, oh, it's very kind, etc., etc., then she's much more likely to do that again for that person because they're so grateful. And if someone is ungrateful for the gift, they're unlikely to receive the same level of gifts in the future. And it's that self-promoting, that positive cycle of gratitude and abundance that sort of needs to be moved towards nature, that if we're grateful for the gifts of nature, then we are more likely to preserve nature and want abundance in nature and push that. And it's that ecological push on those lines as well. And that was really forthright in the book and forcefully made. And it made me, you know, this book made me think of several other books. It made me think of Silent Spring and the ecological, you know, devastation that humanity is causing on the world. You think of climate change, etc., etc. It made me think of the sixth extinction as well, which is another really good book discussing the extinction of species. Again, a lot of it human impacts. It made me think of is it the Anthropocene? I'll put these titles up, because I think about the Anthropocene as well, which again, human impact on the world. And also, the one point in the book as well, she talks a lot about the science ignoring indigenous wisdom, and or wisdom of people who have lived in these areas for a long time, ignoring local knowledge. And we have seen a lot of that in history. And I would hope science has changed and moved forward in that sense. But, you know, we should still use evidence and evidence-based. We shouldn't just accept hearsay for what, you know, as fact, but we should listen to what people are saying and then use the hypotheses that they're making and test them out and see if they're actually scientifically valid or not. And there are, you know, there's lots of instances where local knowledge is backed by science and it's worked for many years because there is a scientific basis for it. And it's understanding that scientific basis, for me, also helps increase human knowledge and understanding and the sharing of it and how we can use it elsewhere for the benefit, hopefully, of society in a general sense, not just in the human sense, but in the global world sense of all beings. So this book has some huge points it wants to make, and it generally makes them well. As I say before, there's a little bit around the genius of plants that didn't hit me perfectly, but there's some really key insights and key points of wisdom that I think anybody in this world would benefit from at least having reinforced if they don't already believe in those points. Now, the impact we're having as a human society on the world is enormous, and you know, you hear it in the news every day of the week, but it is interesting to think of the world. And if we put some of the lessons she puts out in this book first, you know, appreciation, gratitude first, and trying to think of the world and us being part of the world rather than separating us from the world is critical, I think, to the success of humanity in the future. And I think engaging science within that is absolutely vital. Of course, engaging science in that in a way that begets abundance. Those are some of my thoughts on this book, and there's probably more to say. It's been quite a thought-provoking process reading this book, and I want to thank Lynn again for recommending it. It has really made me think about the world, and it's confirmed some things I thought. It's put different spins on things I thought. So that's my thoughts on Braiding Sweetgrass. If you're interested in reading this, please do let me know what you think of it when you've read it. If you have read it, what were your thoughts on this book? And what would you think of the insights that Robin Wall Kimmerer made through this book? I'd be very interested to know. Let me know in the comments. That's all I have for you in this book review. So thank you for watching. And if you did enjoy it, like, comment, subscribe, share with your friends and family. And I'll see you in the next one. Bye.